So if you've been not, if you've not been getting email from me, put your name at the top. If you have, please put your name at the bottom, just because I gave last week's list to someone else. So just for me to remember your names, I want a list here. And then every lecture, I will go around the room and practice pronouncing your name. So let me start this way. Let me start down here. Now, how many chairs? I do not get to sit. So here. So we have enough chairs, yes?
And also, there's a small conference room that have a bunch of chairs.
Yeah, but then the conference room can't work as a conference room. whereas in my office, I can't use my office when I'm teaching. So if we take the chairs from my office, then we are not inconveniencing anybody. But we have enough for now. But of course, the class hasn't officially started yet. So when people come in late, that's when we'll have to stop and get chairs. So last week, I think I spoke a little bit too much. So this week, well, it's really good to get off to a good start, because oftentimes courses really start too slowly, because there's an enormous amount. This is lecture two of the University of Ottawa Nonlinear Optics course. So I did not make that mistake. That's the thing. You say, well, I will not repeat those mistakes. I will make a whole new set of mistakes all on my own. But very often, courses get off to a very slow start because there's a lot of introductory material that you just have to get through before you can start teaching the course. But I think we pretty much got through all of the elementary things and even some of the not-so-elementary things. So we can really jump into things today, but it will not be quite as intense and quite as lengthy as it was last week. Now, professors are supposed to be absent-minded. So I forget the very last thing that I did in the last lecture. If anybody was taking notes, can you just tell me what the very last topic was?
You talked about spatial symmetry, and then you said something like...
D-effect. Wait, let me just take a look. Yes. This is scary. I opened it up to the right page. Did I show you this picture? Did I show you this picture?
No.
Okay, but I did. I'm trying to get the whole thing. Did I present this material? I'm teaching the same course in Rochester. And the lectures are out of sync, so that's why I lose track. Contracted notation.
This is for...
So did you see this?
No.
Ah, you imagined that I presented this.
Wait.
We need a tiebreaker. One person says that I presented this. One person says I didn't present this.
No.
Okay. Whew. I'm not losing my mind yet. Okay, so 50. I think I've made some very, very general introductory comments. But then we never got past that. So, how many chairs are we missing? So, why don't you... I think my office is unlocked.
There are five or six chairs in the...
Right. But then they can't use the meeting room but if you take them from my office, it's not a problem because I can't use my office while I'm here. So would you just go to my office and it's the blue chairs. 456. Yeah. Okay. There's an obvious mnemonic for remembering 456. This would be on the final exam. What is the mnemonic for remembering my office number? Okay, so let's talk about. Spatial symmetry. So what is spatial symmetry about? Let me give you a small demonstration here. If I take this sheet of paper and rotate it by 180 degrees, it looks exactly the same. So you could say that this is a twofold axis of symmetry. Now, let me instead take this paper and turn it into a square. And now I can turn it by 90 degrees, 90 degrees, 90 degrees. And it looks the same after any of those. So I can call this a four-fold axis of symmetry. Now, I'll turn the paper around. There is writing on the paper. So now up and down are distinguishable. So this is no longer a symmetry axis. This is called a one-fold axis of symmetry. The only thing you can do to get it back to where you started is to go all the way around. That is so obvious, right? There are people called mathematicians who spend their entire lives systematizing that very simple thought that I've just given you. And this is a mathematical field known as group theory. And in broad terms, this is the study of the symmetry properties. Well, group theory in general is the study of symmetry properties, but I will say of crystals. And in fact, group theory in a very real sense grew out of crystallography. People would find these crystals that did strange, exotic things, birefringence, and would, during the break, remind me to get my calcite crystal. Crystals have some very, very strange optical properties. People were trying to make sense of this. They were trying to distinguish what crystal lattices look like. So, I mean, you know the story, and I'm not a great artist, but there are crystals that form cubic lattices. So there would be one atom here, maybe a different atom here, one atom here, maybe a different atom here. And of course, sodium chloride is an example of a crystal that forms this sort of crystalline structure. So, this is what's called a cubic lattice. Now, what group theory can tell you is that there is no birefringence. And of course, that supposes that you know what birefringence is. So what is birefringence? We say that something is birefringent if there are two possible refractive indices for each k vector. And so, for example, you might have a wave propagating in this direction, and the wave might be polarized like this, or the wave might be polarized like this. I'll draw this to be polarized out of the plane of the board. And this one might have a refractive index that we call the ordinary refractive index, and this one that we call the extraordinary refractive index. So NO not equals NE is what we mean by birefringence. So the things I've just talked about were linear optics. So what we want to talk about next is how does crystal symmetry influence nonlinear optics? Now, we still need a little bit more background material. There are 32 different crystal point groups. Now, what is a point group? It's a list of all symmetry properties of a given crystal. And let me give, yes?
This number of 32, it comes from group theory or no, just by experiment?
Well, it's theoretical.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we'll get at this.
Yeah.
Take paper and pencil, write down every symmetry you can imagine, and then count how many there are.
And all of these are real symmetry. I mean that in physical world we can see all of them. Yeah.
I'm going to give you. Let me give you an example. There's a crystal point group that's called 3M. And what this means is that there's a threefold axis, which we talked about already, and this is a mirror plane. So people sometimes just draw this symbolically. If you have an equilateral triangle with an axis at the center, this would be what you would call a threefold axis. And now, just by convention, the mirror plane means that there's a plane that looks like this, so that when you reflect in the mirror, you see the same thing here and the same thing here. So, this is one of the homework problems in the book, but it's not a serious problem. It says, derive all 32 point groups. The solution to that homework problem would be about the same as the length of the rest of the book. So I've never assigned this one, but it's on the list of problems at the end of the chapter. But I mean, you can imagine. You just you consider all the symmetries that are possible, and then what you'll find is that actually you thought that this and this were different, but they're actually the same. So at your first go through, you'll probably end up with more than 32 until you realize that some of them are equivalent to one another. Now, I said crystal point groups. There are point groups for molecules that cannot exist for crystals. So, the point group must be consistent with periodicity. Right. Crystals are periodic. Now, you say, surely there's no example you can give me, but there is. The example is that five-fold symmetry can occur in molecules, but not crystals. How many of you knew that already? Okay, good. If it was everybody, then you don't need a professor anymore. So, I'm going to prove this to you. But
wasn't there a Nobel Prize?
What?
Wasn't there a Nobel Prize linked to
that? I didn't hear.
Wasn't there a Nobel Prize linked to that?
Yeah, proving that what I said is wrong. Okay. No, but these were quasi crystals. I mean, you look, but they're not really crystals. I mean, they're things that if you're not very careful, you say, hey, that's a counterexample. You say, well, no. If you, it's actually not periodic. So. Okay, so here's the idea. Let me do my best attempt to draw a pentagon. I think carbon hexafluoride has a five-fold axis of symmetry. But so you can find molecules that have a five-fold axis of symmetry. But as is well known to floor technicians going back millennia, you cannot tile your bathroom floor with a sequence of pentagons. So this is a fun thing. Go home and try it. It's like paper dolls, right? Cut out a whole sequence of pentagons and then try to stack them together so that you fill the entire plane and you cannot do it. So I think this illustrates the point perfectly. This is why these are called crystal point groups. That compatible with the spatial periodicity of a crystal, there's 32 and only 32 ways in which you can form a crystal. Now, why is this important? Eleven of these point groups contain an inversion center. Inversion center meaning that square lattice. Here's the inversion center. You take this point, you invert it through the center, you get this point. You take this point, invert it through the center, and you get this point, etc. So this is called an improper rotation. a proper rotation is a true rotation. You can imagine rotate by 90 degrees and then invert through the origin. That would be an improper rotation. Now the obvious question is, who cares? Why in the world do you care that 11 of the 32 crystal point groups contain an inversion center? It's because one can show that chi 3 is identically zero for, these are called centrosymmetric crystals. Oh, luckily I wrote what I meant. It's usually the other way around. This morning somebody wrote to both Paul Corkin and me and said, hey, do you know person X? And the message, person X's name was so badly mangled that Paul Corkin had no idea who she was talking about. But I said, oh, of course I do. Because I knew what she meant, not what she said. Sometimes by, why in the world, it's a big, big person in our university, why in the world would she have asked me if I knew this person who happened to be a Nobel Prize winner? Didn't matter how badly she had misspelled his name. It was clear from context. Okay, so chi 2 vanishes identically for central symmetric crystals. So that's a huge insight. It means don't even bother to try to do second harmonic generation in a material of this sort. So let's prove this result and let's see where it comes from. Oh, by the way, this is very sad. Nobody could read the lecture notes from the movie, because I was using blue, and the blue didn't have enough contrast. So the physics department is putting a huge amount of money into the taping of these lectures, and the first one turned out to be of dubious usefulness.
How can access to the movies?
I can't hear you. There's a truck outside.
How can access to the movies?
Oh! Oh, you remind me to send you the link. Well, it can work both ways. Now, there's a piece of paper. If I write down, there's at least a chance I'll remember to do it. Send link for movie. I did not send it, is that correct? No, nobody got it. Okay, it's right on my computer here. Is there anything else I promised you to do? Not yet. So you see, that confirms the point I was making. I was talking about crystal symmetry, so when you said, how do I access the movie, I had no idea what you were talking about. So what does that have to do with the symmetry properties of nonlinear optical materials? Okay, so chi 2 vanishes. So this is a small proof that chi 2 equals 0 for central symmetric. Material. This will be a proof by contradiction. If there was a nonlinear response, it would be described by P of T is equal to epsilon 0 chi 2 E of T squared. But now, if the material has inversion symmetry, we would argue that the field minus E must produce polarization minus P. Your memory is worse than mine. I'm supposed to bring the calcite. Okay, if it has inversion symmetry, then the field minus E must produce the polarization minus P of T. So minus P of T must equal epsilon 0 chi 2 minus E of T squared. I think you can see where this is heading, which is equal to epsilon 0 chi 2 E of T squared, but that's just P of T. So if P of T is equal to minus P of T, this implies that P of T equals 0. And if this is true for any E of T, this implies that chi 2 is equal to 0. Beautiful proof, ironclad proof, hard to deny, sheds almost no insight as to why it's true. there's a picture I want to draw for you now that does a much, much better job of explaining why this is so. And it also will allow me to introduce some concepts that I think are crucial for understanding much of the course and for the first homework, which is not irrelevant. So let's first of all assume that the applied field has the following form, that E of T versus T is just a sinusoid. I'll draw two periods of it. And now, what would happen for a material with a linear response? Now, a very useful way of thinking about this is to consider the potential well that binds the electron to its equilibrium position. And for linear response, the potential well will just be a parabola, right? Because this is something like Hooke's law, meaning that F is equal to minus kx, and then u of x is the integral of f of x dx, which is just 1 half kx squared. A calculation you've done hundreds of times, even in your young lives. So linear response leads to a potential well in the form of a parabola. But just going back to f equals minus kx, we see that the response is going to look something like this. Now, what about nonlinear case? And let's first think of centrosymmetric. In this case, the potential well can deviate significantly from a parabola, but it has to deviate in a way that respects the symmetry of x being equivalent to minus x. So the actual potential well might look like this. Now, of course, you could say, well, why did I draw it this way? It could deviate from a parabola in the other direction, but this is usually by far the more physical situation. the restoring force gets weaker the farther you get away from the equilibrium position. And we know that that's how nature really works, because you can photoionize an atom. You can apply electric field that is strong enough to just rip the electron away. So if it's in this case here, and I will exaggerate, the waveform will deviate from a sinusoid, but has to deviate in a way that is equivalent between being pulled up and being pulled down. So you might get something like this. Again, very much exaggerated, that the further you pull the electron away from its equilibrium position, the weaker the restoring force becomes, and it becomes easier to pull it further away. But now, nonlinear, non-central, In this case here, the potential well can be different for pulling it in one direction as opposed to pulling it in the other. So here I've drawn it that the spring gets stronger in one dimension and weaker in the other direction. And of course, imagine a real spring. Once you push it together so much that the coils push against one another, it becomes really, really hard to compress it more. So this is actually not so unreasonable to think that this might be the model of a true spring. Yes?
I still have a question. What's the correlation between the graph on the left and the...
Okay.
I mean...
Oh, okay. This is the potential well that binds the electron to its equilibrium position. We are to think of the electron as bouncing back and forth in this potential well. It's going to be a very, very physical interpretation here. The electron is bouncing back and forth with this much energy. It gets to this point, it turns around. Okay. Here, it's a different potential well. Because it's a different potential well, if you don't excite the electron very strongly, it's bouncing back and forth down here. And it's essentially a linear response. If you excite the electron more strongly, so that it's bouncing back and forth up here, you will get a much more strong, a much stronger nonlinear contribution, and you will get something like this. We yell at students for this. I did not label my axes. So this is P of T, and again here. P of T as a function of T. And here, let's say it's a very strong restoring force in one direction and a very weak restoring force in the other. A strong in this direction and a weak in this direction. Now, the point is that you can, if this is frequency omega, the linear response, of course, is at frequency omega. But you can synthesize this waveform by frequencies omega, 3 omega, 5 omega, etc. You do not need any even multiples of the initial frequency. But for this one here, you have 0 frequency, omega, 2 omega, 3 omega, etc. So I think here's another way of understanding this general result, that for a centrosymmetric material, of course it's nonlinear, but it is not nonlinear in a way that can give rise to a second order result, only to a third order result. Okay, so as I mentioned before, maybe this is the simplest example to understand. I mean, you just work that one out. But for each of the 32 point groups, people have worked out the resulting consequence for the possible form of the nonlinear response. And in my book, and in many handbooks, many other books, you will see a little chart that looks like this. And maybe you have seen this before in some books. So this summarizes the consequence of crystal symmetry on the possible nonlinear response of a material. So let's just, I have good news. I'm not going to work out all 32 of them. In fact, I'm not even going to work out the 21 of them that are non-vanishing, right? 11 of them are trivial, zero. But for the other 21, exactly which tensor components vanish and which do not depends on the on which crystal point group you are using. So, and when we finally get this laboratory going, this will be fun because you can walk to the lab and we'll give you a nonlinear crystal and you can twist it in all sorts of different directions and see how the nonlinear response varies because of the tensor nature of the nonlinear response. So, example of interpreting this sort of chart and 3M. Same example as before, so let's use it again. In this chart, you will find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And this is supposed to be a representation of the DIL matrix that we talked about last time. And for class 3M, you will find that there is a black dot here, an open circle here, an open circle here, a black dot there, a black dot here, black dot, black dot, black dot. And then what you'll find is that some of these dots are connected to one another. This and this. And the legend means that this is a non-zero element. This is the opposite sign to this. So every open circle is connected to a filled circle. That means that these are equal and opposite. And the dashed line means valid under Kleinman symmetry. So if Kleinman symmetry is valid, this is equal to the negative of this. If it is not valid, then there need be no connection. What happened here? Let me make this. There. Could this be capillary action? I keep filling them in, and then the center disappears. It's like an OEM beam, right? It's turning itself into a donut as we watch. Or the classroom is haunted. Okay, so I guess that's about it. So here is poor D33 just sitting there on its own, not connected to anything else. And you'll recall that D33 is the same as D333 which corresponds to chi 2, well, z, z, z. So, so this is what people call the totally diagonal element of the nonlinear tensor. And very often it's the largest, sort of for reasons that are obvious. I forget if I've told this story before. Think how implausible chi xyz is. It's as if I ask somebody at the end of the table to push the table this way. Simultaneously, I will push the table this way, and the table suddenly rises in the air. Of course, it's a nonlinear anisotropic system. But this tells you that it responds in a direction different from that of either of the applied fields. You don't expect that to be a big effect, do you? Whereas chi zzz, you push it in a certain direction, and the response is not exactly what you would have expected based on the linear Hooke's law model. Okay, so maybe enough about that. And if we can find some, well, these, I mean, there are great homework problems associated with this type of behavior. I don't want to leave this thought hanging. Let's just call this some consequences. Let's talk about gallium arsenide. This is another important photonic material. You can build photodetectors out of it. It crystallizes in point group 4 bar 2m. A fourfold axis, twofold axis, a mirror plane, and this one also has inversion symmetry, if I recall correctly. These things are fun. So there's a bibliography at the end of the chapter telling you where you could learn more about group theory. If you go back to the chart in the book, you will find that for gallium arsenide, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the only non-zero elements are this, this, and this, and they are all equal. So that's pleasantly simple, isn't it? We were fearful in the last lecture that there could be as many as 27 independent elements of the chi 2 tensor. But for gallium arsenide, well, look how symmetric it is. And the longer its name is, the more symmetric it is. I mean, it has a fourfold axis and a twofold axis and a mirror plane. What are these? Well, D14 is equal to D25 is equal to D36. And let me remind you that D14, when expanded, is D123. And we can call this the totally off diagonal. Element. The element that I just mentioned a moment ago defies all common sense, that it responds in a direction different from that of either of the two applied fields. Uh, but it has a cubic lattice. I mean, gallium arsenide is, does have a cubic lattice. That means that there is no birefringence. So, by the way, that means you cannot use birefringence phase matching, but I'm getting ahead of myself right now. I think the point I want to make here is that how strongly counterintuitive all of this is. Here is a material that is so symmetric it cannot even have birefringence, but it has a second-order nonlinear response. Or another way of putting this is that centrosymmetry is not the same thing as a cubic lattice. And now you have a question here.
Yeah, so D123 was totally off diagonal, but it was like three dimensions. So you have like D123.
Yes. So let me remind you, there's a rule for turning the two-dimensional, for turning the two subscript value into the three subscript value. The one remains a one, but four, there's a lookup table, and the four means 2, 3. Or D, X, Y, Z, if you prefer. So, I mean, throughout the literature, some people use X, Y, Z, some people use 1, 2, 3, as you probably know from taking courses, because different professors use different notation. So did I answer your question?
No, I still confused.
So what is the question?
The question is, why D14? So I know one,
so oh,
one,
how do I get from here to here? How do I get from here to So I left my lecture notes at home, and I had to print them out again. So if I find that page, I will just give it to you. But here. That is a gift.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so... Okay, so that's 57A. So let's look more at the fact that it's a cubic lattice. And in fact, gallium arsenide forms, crystallizes in what is known as the zinc blend structure. For historical reasons that we don't need to go into right now. The zinc blend structure is very similar to the diamond lattice. But diamond diamond shows birefringence. No. Diamond is centrosymmetric. But gallium arsenide is not centrosymmetric, even though they crystallize in the same lattice. So here is a picture from the book, which I will actually pass this around the room so that you can take a look at it, because I know you don't want me to know that you have a pirated version of my book. So you can't really look at it during lecture, right? You have to do this in the privacy of your homes. But here is the diamond structure, and let's consider two nearest neighbors, and you go exactly halfway, the halfway point between those two nearest neighbors, and that is a point of inversion symmetry. So diamond possesses inversion symmetry. But in gallium arsenide, instead of these both being carbons, one is gallium and the other is arsenic. So they're different. So the point halfway between is not a point of inversion symmetry. So so the moral of the story is that knowing the Bravais lattice is not enough. You also have to know the unit cell to speak solid state language. And if you don't speak that language, don't worry. There's lots of languages I don't speak either. But it's what you put in the cell. It's not the overall symmetry. It also depends on exactly what the constituents are that determines whether it is or whether it is not centrosymmetric. So you take a look and just pass it around then. Actually, no, I can't pass it. Actually, and you can pass this one around this way. So it would go around twice as fast. Okay, maybe the last topic in chapter one is to talk about time domain descriptions of nonlinear optics. So up until now, we have formulated the laws of nonlinear optics in the frequency domain. But any good engineer knows that anything you can do in the frequency domain, you can do in the time domain, and vice versa. So I don't want to belabor this point, but let's just take a real quick look at how we would describe nonlinear optics in the time domain. So frequency domain, that's what we've been doing up until now. And for example, we say we put monochromatic light at omega 1, monochromatic light at omega 2, into a nonlinear crystal, and we get out light at omega 3 equals omega 1 plus omega 2. But now, if instead we wanted to describe this in the time domain, we might want to do something like the following. So we have an input field which we'll just call E of t. And this E of t might have some sort of irregular waveform. And we pass this through, let's just say some arbitrary nonlinear material. And the light that comes out, we can call E out of t, and it will have a different type of waveform. So how do you predict the output waveform in terms of the input waveform? And maybe more from a conceptual point of view than from a mathematical point of view, but there are times that you may really want to do the whole thing in the time domain. Ultra-short pulses might be an obvious example where you don't want to work in the frequency domain. The pulse being short means that spectrum is very, very broad. The whole conceptual picture of two monochromatic waves interacting with one another just doesn't work for ultra-short pulses. So you might very much prefer to be working in the time domain. Let me first remind you how this works for linear response, which in concept you all know. Right? You've taken Fourier transforms before in your life. But then we will see how to generalize this thought and describe nonlinear interactions in the time domain. So how would you do linear response? Well, I think you would say that P1 of t is equal to the integral from minus infinity to infinity R1 of tau e to the t minus tau d tau. And here R1 is called the linear response function. Now, why do I write that down? Because this is the only possibility of a relationship that is both linear and, well, I hate using jargon, time shift invariant. You've heard this concept before, time shift invariant? If you haven't, wonderful. Because I'd rather talk in natural language than in this. It means no preferred origin of time. So, what this relationship says is that the polarization at time t depends on the electric field at all other moments of time, and the relative importance of things in the distant past falls off because this impulse response function becomes very much very small for very large values of tau. Now, let's impose a concept of causality. We think that the polarization now can depend on the previous values of the field, but not on the future values of the field. So causality requires that R1 of tau vanish for tau negative. So in the future, I will often just write the lower limit of integration to be zero because this response function vanishes for negative values of tau. Now, let me define Fourier transforms. Of course, there are at least 8 different definitions in common usage. I will tell you mine, and I will tell you why I like it. I will define E of t to be the integral minus infinity to infinity of E of omega e to the minus I omega t the omega over 2 pi. And I will put the 2 pi here for the obvious reason that this was never omega. It was 2 pi nu. And for convenience, people started to introduce a new symbol for 2 pi nu to save them from pen strokes. And then they took themselves too seriously and thought that omega was the actual important variable. And then the inverse transform, E of omega minus infinity to infinity, et, e to the plus I, omega t, dt, without the 2 pi. So I use the same letter of the alphabet because 26 letters aren't quite enough, even upper and lower case, so it's really nice to use the same letter for the time and the frequency domain. I put the minus sign here in part because Schrodinger did. Right? When you solve Schrodinger's equation, you always put the minus sign in front of the positive frequency solutions. It's a physicist thing. I don't know why we do it, but consistently within physics, we put the minus sign in front of the positive frequency solution. So if you change conventions between quantum mechanics and electromagnetic theory, what in the world happens when you want to quantize the electromagnetic field? So I will do it this way here. And of course, you've seen many, many other conventions. So now let's make use of this. And let's write the polarization in terms of the frequency content of the field. So then, P1 of t is equal to the integral from 0 to infinity, d tau, integral from minus infinity to infinity, d omega over 2 pi, R1 of tau, E of omega, e to the minus I omega t minus tau. So all that I've done is here replaced E of t minus tau by this expression here. And now let me just change the order in which I write terms on the right-hand side. Write this as d omega over 2 pi d tau, 0 to infinity, and then R1 of tau, E of omega, R1 of tau, E to the I omega tau, E of omega, E to the minus I omega t. So just break this up and reorder things. And now this integral, so this depends only on tau, but not t, whereas the rest of this has the t dependence. So I will just define this to be chi 1 of omega. And then this becomes p1 of t is equal to the integral minus infinity to infinity d omega over 2 pi chi 1 of omega e of omega e to the minus I omega t. Make sure you're with me. But now let's just come to the definition of with the tilde, of course. Now let's come back to the definition of Fourier transform. So I could just as well write this as the integral minus infinity to infinity p1 of omega e to the minus I omega t d omega over 2 pi. So compare this to this, and you see that they're equal if we take p1 of omega. There's an epsilon zero floating around, which we won't. I'll just drop the epsilon zero. You can put it back wherever you want. So this tells you that p1 of omega is equal to chi, well, I'll put it here, is epsilon zero chi 1 of omega e of omega. So this result, so in the frequency domain, this is a complex quantity. This is a complex quantity. The susceptibility chi 1 is also a complex quantity. The way you can allow the possibility of a phase shift between the polarization and the driving field is to ascribe a complex nature to the linear susceptibility. In the time domain, let me now just replace this with the zero. In the time domain, the polarization is a convolution integral. It says that the polarization now depends on the field at all prior moments of time with a weighting factor that we call the linear response function. So here is the result for the linear response in the time domain and the frequency domain. Now, I think everyone probably recognizes that all I've done is to derive the convolution theorem. But when I teach this by saying, I will now invoke the convolution theorem, people nod their heads, but it really doesn't sink in. Here, every step along the way, I insisted that it made physical sense to me. In fact, I am that naive. I had been giving this lecture for a couple of years before I realized that this is nothing but the convolution theorem, because I wasn't thinking mathematically. I really like to think in these other terms. Let's see, we started at 2. Okay, so let's go a little bit more before we take our break. So now let's ask, how would we do nonlinear response in the time domain? Well, this will be strongly motivated by what we just did. You can imagine that the formulas become more and more complicated as you go into the nonlinear regime. But once you understand what we just did, you can almost write these down by inspection. So let's call this second order response in the time domain. And what you might argue is that P2 of t is the integral from minus infinity to infinity d tau 1 minus infinity to infinity d tau 2 second order response function r 2 of tau 1 tau 2 e of t minus tau 1 E of t minus tau 2. And now again, causality will tell us we have to insist that R2 of tau 1 tau 2 vanishes for tau 1 or tau 2 negative. Now, how do we know this is correct? We know this is correct is that it's the only form, bilinear, quadratic, the product of two linear responses, bilinear in E, and depends and is time shift invariant. we can see why people use that word. You don't have to write it out in such a complicated fashion. Now we ask, what is P of T in terms of the frequency content of E of T? So now we just substitute here the Fourier transform of these two quantities, and we find that P2 of T is equal to d omega 1 over 2 pi d omega 2 over 2 pi d tau 1 from 0 to infinity. I will use the convention that if you don't specify, it's minus infinity to infinity. D tau 1 integral 0 to infinity d tau 2 r 2 of tau 1 tau 2. E of omega 1, e to the minus I omega 1, t minus tau 1, e of omega 2, e to the minus I omega 2, t minus tau 2. And now I can't bring myself to write this out over and over and over again. If you're following the linear case, you know where the thought is heading. So you can write this. You can verify this trivially, that this can be written as d omega 1 over 2 pi d omega 2 over 2 pi times chi 2 omega sigma omega 1 omega 2 e of omega 1 e of omega 2 e to the minus I omega sigma t. By the way, omega sigma is defined to be omega 1 plus omega 2. The mnemonic is that sigma is as in sum. So I will very often, when I want a generic expression for a sum frequency, I'll call it omega sigma. So now I've defined something here where chi 2 omega sigma, omega 1, omega 2 is equal to, yep, integral 0 to infinity d tau 1, 0 to infinity d tau 2, r 2, tau 1, tau 2, e to the I, omega 1, tau 1, plus omega 2, tau 2. So, by inspection, we identify P2, the second order polarization, as chi 2 times e of omega 1, e of omega 2, with an epsilon 0. At some point in my life, I will introduce into this lecture. And you do the same thing for chi 3. And what you find for chi 3 is that you can introduce a third-order response function. You require that it be causal, and you find that the third-order susceptibility is the three-dimensional Fourier transform of the third-order response function into the frequency domain. Okay, perfect time to take a small break. So let's do that. And then when I come back, I'm going to have a second round of learning everyone's name. I should really lock my door. This strikes me as unwise.
I remember Hugo started working in 2014 or 2013, right? 2013.
Probably.
Yeah.
No, I think earlier, but you could ask him. It could even be 2012.
I still don't understand. When you say like you go back to Rochester, back and forth to Iowa.
Yes.
And when did you leave? Because you still work there.
Right, well, yes.
So you leave?
I usually leave.
On the weekend?
Well, yeah, so I go there on Thursday afternoon.
Thursday,
I teach on Friday. On Saturday, I meet with my students.
Okay.
Yeah. I tell them, no one ever said you have to be my graduate student. This just has to be. I work full time in Ottawa. If you want to be my student in Rochester, the only time I can come in is Saturday.
Oh, okay.
So it's a beautiful, beautiful system because only truly dedicated students then. I mean, I could do the same thing here, except in Rochester I have an excuse. I can say, well, I can say this is the situation. My course is not a required course. You're not required to have me as a thesis supervisor, so you can decide. It works out well. Does the camera agree? We're not at all sure. The Rochester people are probably laughing right now.
So you don't take one day off?
No.
Oh my God. You should take some overdue holidays.
Well, I do on occasion. No, but look. What are the professional options for somebody like me? I could become a Boy Scout leader, and then I would get to work with young people, train them, help them to develop in a certain way. This way, they don't pay scoutmasters a lot of money, but they pay professors a lot of money. What I do for a living is what most people do as a hobby. Right? I have a little workshop. I tinker around my workshop, build toys, go to the lab, shoot laser beams through things. I have an incredibly good time. I mean, I can't imagine I would do it for free. And they pay me for it. Okay, so now you ask, so what do I do? So on weekends, I go to Rochester so I can have even more fun. So I have fun 5 days a week in Ottawa, and I have fun 2 days a week in Rochester.
Where do you have more fun?
Yeah, which means you don't have time for your...
Well, in Rochester, by definition, they're not paying me at Rochester. So I'm doing it... So I guess you have to say in Rochester I'm doing it only for fun. But it's different fun.
Yeah.
No, I mean, my program here is four times larger.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I would not give this up. But
you still have other errands and also have to do chores and also...
Oh, yeah. Oh, I have a lot of nervous energy. Don't we all? Wait. I don't know.
So you don't sleep? I
need my sleep, but I try to work efficiently when I'm... I try to work very efficiently when I'm awake. You get better at this. Let's see. No weak student would want to join my group. So I tend to get only the very, very best students. And the very, very best students, I give them all the advice I can, but they have to do the work. And they want that, I want that. So it works. Okay, so let's just, so we're teaching me to learn people's names. Kyle Johnson, he's Aiden. Yeah. We got that one, because it either does or does not mean out of the fiery wood. Saad? Yeah. You have a long name. Is Alam a common name?
Yeah.
It's a very common name. Considering I have two students both named Alam. So why do you say MD?
Muhammad.
Why not just M?
Oh, actually, in my country, it's very common to write this name in brief, like MD.
Yeah, but most do M period. I more often see just the letter M.
But I don't know why in my country,
No, I understand, but that was not my question. Some people do like M Zahirul, but you do M D.
Actually, it confirms that it's Muhammad.
Yeah. Oh, because this could be Monsieur.
Yeah.
He could be a Frenchman. Yeah. Okay. Okay. But you could be a medical doctor. So. Okay. Jefferson? And tell me again. The Z ending is a possessive?
No.
What did...
It means that you are son of.
Son of.
Fair flower.
Son of. This is standard Spanish?
Yes.
Okay. I never learned that one.
There are many last names.
Like, you know, in English we have Anderson. Yeah. Johnson. Son of John. Spanish, Flores. Hijo? Hijo de Flora. The man's name is Flora? Flora? Flora. Yeah, okay. Hijo de Flora is Flores, okay. Helena? Helena?
Mm-hmm.
The accent on the first. Helena. Helena Drica. Druka. Druka, okay. Wei Tui?
Yeah.
Wei Tui. Jennifer Erskine? Oh. Elham?
Yes.
Ah, okay. Elham? Elkamash? Elkamash. And if you don't mind, what country are you from?
Saudi Arabia.
And was that a recognizably Saudi name?
Yes.
It's, okay. Well, I've learned something then. Now, Alan Godfrey, you were... Yeah, that's... Yeah. I just saw you this morning.
Yes.
Yeah, that's me.
Alan Godfrey.
Maxwell, yeah.
Okay. Sheng Han?
Jinzo.
Well, no. Anybody can say Maxwell. Zhen Shou?
Yeah.
Zhen Shou. If you wanted an English name, it could be John Hall. Or John Shaw.
Yeah.
Yeah, John Shaw.
Actually, Hugen pronounced my name really well.
Okay. Oh, Andrew Parks. We've lost him, right? Pedram? Pedram. We know he was here. David Sanchez? Ah, David. Yeah. And you're leaving soon?
Yeah, 2 weeks.
Okay. Peru?
Ecuador.
Ecuador. Close, right? Julian. Ah. Julian Samson Cornick.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Jeremiah O'Neill, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Red Beard. Guillemot or not? Okay, and now Shima Elkamaki? I said it that badly? Let's try another one. We do process of elimination. Nadra?
Yeah.
Okay, Nadra.
Aldaifi.
Okay, that's an F. Aldaifi. Okay. Devor Kirk. Ashwag. Hakami. The name is Arabic, yes?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you are from where?
Okay.
Yeah. And Aza? Aza Ben Taher? Does Ben mean son of? No. Daughter of? Ben can be either daughter or son?
Yeah.
Okay. Aza Ben Taher.
Yeah.
So it means daughter of Taher. And is your father really named Taher? Or is that just a...
last name.
It's just the last name is Ben Taher. Okay. And now El Malki.
She's
out here. Oh, okay. So we hope we can read the handwriting. That was the problem from before. Okay, so let's get going again. Now, you ask, why in the world did we spend so much time learning how to express these results in the time domain? Question?
Yes, we stopped with two integrals for our 2D transform. So would there be a way to rewrite the integrals as a function of omega sigma? And the other integral, I don't know, would probably be a convolution between the two electric fields?
So, best answer is I don't know. I mean, formally you can write this as omega sigma minus omega 1. And then...
Yes? It is the polarization of omega sigma.
Yeah.
We're not doing the Fourier transform on the variable omega sigma. Sorry, we're doing the Fourier transform.
Yeah, No, I'm thinking.
Yeah,
Well, in a sense, this is just a formality here. Think of this as omega 1 plus omega 2. I just was saving ink by writing it this way. So what this is telling us is that the polarization at time t can be written in this form. And of course, since it's the product of two different fields, we would expect it to oscillate at the sum frequency. It's taking me a while to absorb the question. So
like my question was, will there be a way where we would change the variable of integration to make it here, omega sigma, and then the other one probably transform? Or the argument of the electric field will probably adapt to that, and then we'll see a convolution appear between the two electric fields? Because when we started, when I read the first equation in the time domain, I read a convolution between R and the two electric fields. And I see a multiplication between the two electric fields. So what I expect at the end is multiplication with I and then convolution in between the two electric fields.
Let's both think. I just can't answer the question that quickly. These things are very tricky, right? They're not tricky, but you can get yourself all messed up if you're not thinking the right way. So let's both think about this, and we can talk more about it later. Okay, so one reason we wanted to do this is to move into the topic of the Cramer's-Kronig relations. So how many of you have studied Cramer's-Kronig relations? Okay, good. So, but the rest of you at least can learn something out of today's lecture. So just to tell you where this is heading, I want to first remind you what the Cramer's-Kronig relations are, and then ask the question, are there Cramer's-Kronig relations in nonlinear optics? Now, if you read a book like Landau and Lifshitz, they will tell you that the Cramer's-Kronig relations are extremely general in nature. All that they depend upon is causality and linearity. So we're throwing out one of the key assumptions behind the standard Cramer's-Kronig relations, and we then have to ask ourselves, are there still? And the answer is, sometimes yes, sometimes no. It's an issue of detail. So it's something we need to get into. So let's first remind ourselves how the Cramer's-Kronig relations work for linear optics, and then we'll see how to generalize this for the nonlinear case. So let's call this note to self, don't leave the pen uncapped. Cramer's-Kronig relations. Okay, so let me just recap what we just saw, that in linear optics we can express chi 1 of omega as the integral of some linear response function, like so. And now you ask, what are the properties of this response function? Because if you know the properties of this, you can use it to deduce the properties of that. So here are some of the properties that we've talked about already. There's causality, which is a statement that R1 of tau vanishes for tau less than zero, reality. These quantities, E of t and P of t, are real. And this implies by the Fourier transform relations that chi 1 of minus omega is equal to chi 1 of omega complex conjugate. So you don't have to calculate separately for positive and negative frequencies. You only have to calculate it for one. And the third property, which is probably the most subtle, is that of analyticity. And this means that chi 1 of omega is analytic in the upper half omega plane. So you studied this in complex analysis, but let's not go back to all the mathematical fundamentals. Let's just remind ourselves what it means to be analytic. And this always struck me as squirrely. You pretend that omega is a complex number? Of course it isn't, but you pretend that it's complex. And then you can express any function of omega as a function in the complex omega plane. So imaginary part of omega on this axis, real part of omega on this axis. Now, how do we show that chi 1 is analytic? I'm trying to plot chi 1. So what you notice is that you have e to the I omega tau here. So in the upper half omega plane, the imaginary part of omega is positive. So I times I is minus 1. And then this integral will vanish. No, this integral will converge because this falls off rapidly as tau goes to infinity. So I'll call this equation 1, and the argument is that the integral converges for imaginary part of omega positive because there's this e to the minus imaginary part of omega times tau that's in this integral, and we're going to infinity. Of course, you see why causality is crucial here, because if you had to integrate from minus infinity to infinity, then you'd be in the lower half plane, and in the lower half plane, you'd have e to the plus here, and there would be no guarantee that the integral converges. So this is point A, but now point B. Along the real axis, it's much trickier to show that the function is analytic. Let's just rely on a physicist's mathematics. You know it's analytic because along the real axis, it's a physical quantity. And you know that you've never in your life got an infinitely large response by applying a laser field to something. Must be analytic because it is, well, let's say it is measurable. Okay, so let's, in any case, let's accept the premise that chi 1 is analytic in the upper half plane. And now to derive the Kramers-Kronig relations, we ask ourselves to evaluate the following integral. I n t is equal to the integral of minus infinity to infinity chi 1 of omega prime d omega prime over omega prime minus omega. Why? Kramers and Kronig each said, wouldn't it be fun to evaluate this integral? Actually, when at the very end, you can get just a little hint of why one might think that it would be fun to evaluate this integral. Maybe it was a final exam question on a mathematical physics course. But for implausible reasons, two people independently said, wouldn't it be fun to evaluate this integral? So let's... I don't want to belabor the discussion. Let's just say that we will treat integrals like this as by their Cauchy principal values. Of course, there's a pole at this point here. So how do you integrate across a pole? Well, there's a prescription. It's called the Cauchy principal value. So we're going to use contour integration. So first of all, what do we want to do? What this says is you want to, the integral we want is the integral along the real axis. There is a pole right here. There is a pole at omega prime equals omega. So how do we do this? Well, we don't really know how to do that, but there are some other integrals that we do know how to do. So one of them is, I'll call this path A. So I'm going to integrate along a path that looks like this, and this. And this, this distance, the radius here, I'll call D1, and we'll let it go to infinity. And this little loop around the pole, let's let this distance be D2, which we will let go to zero. And I guess immediately we know that the integral along path A vanishes. This is Cauchy's theorem. There are no singularities inside this region of integration, so the integral vanishes. But now we wanted this, we have this, so now we have to subtract off this part, and we have to subtract off this part. So B is an integral just of this part here, d1 going limit like so. And now we can also argue that this integral vanishes. And the argument here is a little bit trickier. The path is proportional to the distance d. It's pi times d. The integrand is proportional to 1 over d. So at that point here, you're not sure whether it vanishes or not. But then you argue that in the limit, as d1 goes to infinity, chi 1 of omega prime has to go to 0, because no one's ever found a physical system that will respond to infinitely high frequencies. So as d1 goes to infinity, you're talking about very, very high frequencies where no physical system could possibly respond. So then we are left only with this last little integral here, and this last integral here is the zero crossing. This last integral goes halfway around the pole. So this you can integrate by what is called the residue theorem. So integral along path C is minus pi I times the residue at omega prime equals omega, and that's just what? The susceptibility itself. So this is minus pi I times chi 1 at omega. And so now we put all of this together. Take this. I think we have to do it. So the integral we said is the integral on A. I need to get my sign conventions right. Minus the integral of B minus the integral of C. So that's the minus of this. So the whole thing is just pi I times chi 1 at omega. So to put the whole thing together, it means that chi 1 of omega is equal to 1 over pi I integral minus infinity to infinity, chi 1 omega prime d omega prime minus omega. And let me again check for signs. Yes. So this is the celebrated Cramer-Kronig relation. One is tempted to say that this is about the stupidest result you've ever seen. It says that if you know chi 1 and you perform this extremely complicated integral, you learn something new. No, you don't. You get back to what you started with. So if you know chi 1, you can use it to calculate chi 1. But it's a little bit deeper than that, because then you say, but there's an I here. And that means that the real part of chi 1 bears a relationship to the imaginary part of chi 1 and vice versa. And that might, well, that's not so obvious, is it? Or is it? Every time you see an absorption curve that looks like this, you know that the refractive index looks like this. I mean, you've seen that a million times. So, but you say, oh, but that's only for a harmonic oscillator. Is there always a connection between the imaginary part of a function and the real part of a function? So it's a deeper question, and that's really what the Kramers-Kronig relations are about. It tells you an answer in the affirmative. If you know the real part of a function, you can immediately determine the imaginary part, and vice versa. So to establish this, all we have to do is to separate into real and imaginary parts. Find that the real part of chi 1 of omega prime is 1 over pi, integral minus infinity to infinity, chi 1 imaginary part of chi 1 of omega prime, d omega prime over omega prime minus omega, and that the imaginary part of chi 1 of omega prime is minus 1 over pi integral of the real part of chi 1 of omega prime d omega prime omega prime minus omega. So again, look what this is telling you. If you know the imaginary part of the susceptibility at all frequencies, you can use that to determine the real part of the susceptibility at any frequency, and vice versa. Now, why do we care? Well, I mean, it's incredibly intriguing, right? Okay, so intellectually you say, hey, that's interesting. Why is it useful? Well, because it's easier to measure absorption. Than N of omega. So if you're lazy and you don't want to build an interferometer and you want to determine the refractive index anyway, you just measure the absorption spectrum of the material and you can determine N of omega. Other example is to measure the completeness of spectra. So no spectrometer works all the way from zero frequency to infinite frequency. So let's say that you have a spectrometer that has a working range from omega 1 to omega 2, and you measure a few absorption lines there, and you ask, gee, is it worth my while to buy a spectrometer that works in these different frequency ranges? So what you do, okay, this is the absorption. So in that same region, N, in the same region here, you measure the variation of the refractive index. You take this, you plug it into here. You have to convert absorption to susceptibility, but you're graduate students, you know how to do that. You do this integral, you determine what the refractive index would be, and you see if what you predict is what you measure. If what you measure has much larger variations than what you predict, it's sort of telling you that there are spectral features out here or out here that you overlooked on your first attempt. Okay, so this is why it's considered useful. But then the question is, do we have Cramer's-Cronin relations in nonlinear optics? And you can see the issue here is that you need to convince yourself that your nonlinear susceptibility is analytic in the upper half plane. And there are plenty of examples where it isn't. And there's one given in the homework problem for the chapter. And it says, go to chapter 4, find the quantum mechanical expression for the susceptibility and see if it satisfies Cramer's-Cronin relations or not. I'll give you a huge hint, it doesn't. Okay, so there are plenty of situations in which the nonlinear susceptibility does not satisfy Cramer's-Cronin relations, but there are cases where it does. So are there KK relations and the answer is sometimes. So you really for any particular situation, you really just have to sit down and work it out and see if the Cramer's-Cronin relations are valid or are not. The book is much more general than what I'm going to do here. For lecture today, let me give you one example where it works and one example where it does not work. And I think that's the intuition you want to take around with you, to know when it works and when it doesn't work, and then you can look more precisely at individual cases. Let's start with an example where KK relations hold. And let's say non-degenerate. All frequencies positive. So here we are talking about something like P3 and omega sigma is equal to I'll put the epsilon zero in this time. 6 epsilon zero chi 3 omega sigma omega 1 omega 2 omega 3 e at omega 1, E at omega 2, E at omega 3. So for this particular case, you can write a Cramer's-Kronig relation of the form pi 3 omega sigma omega 1 omega 2 omega 3 is equal to 1 over I pi chi 3 omega sigma prime omega 1 omega 2 prime omega 3 d. Here I'm allowing the second frequency, omega 2, to be the variable, and then divided by omega 2 prime minus omega 2, and just as a note, omega 1 and omega 2 are held fixed, and I've defined omega sigma to be omega 1 plus omega 2 plus omega 3, and omega sigma prime to be omega 1 plus omega 2 prime plus omega 3. Sorry, there's more definition than there is mathematics here. So there is a Cramer's-Kronig relation. So chi 3 is a function of three input frequencies. For any of the three input frequencies, you can write a Cramer's-Kronig relation. And hence, there are three of these. You could write this for omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3. So how would you prove this? So we just proved the Cramer's-Kronig relations for linear optics. The way you prove it here is, to your pleasant surprise, the derivation holds just as it is. You just go line by line, and it's exactly the same as it was before. And the other thing is to note that this is obvious. Because look at this relation. It's linear in E of omega 2. So you hold this fixed, you hold this fixed. It's just a linear relation. So obviously, when the three frequencies are different and they're all positive, you just have the same result as before. Now, let's treat a case where it does not hold. This is chi 3 of omega equals omega plus omega minus omega. So, of course, this is the one that describes an N2 type of nonlinearity. From the point of view of modern engineering photonics, this is crucial. So this is very, very sad that the one case that you're maybe most interested in is the one where it doesn't work. So what is wrong here? so that we don't have to get bogged down over algebra. Before, when we had positive frequencies, we had the pole in the upper half plane, and we could show that there are we could use Cauchy's theorem to show that that first integral vanished. But if one of the frequencies becomes negative, that puts a pole in the upper half plane. Before, there were no poles in the upper half plane. Now you have a pole in the upper half plane. You say, well, I'll just close it in the bottom loop. But you can't, because these put the poles in the upper half plane. So you sort of see what's going wrong. Is that the basic concept of the proof just can't work anymore. Okay, so let's just pause and this is not a bad time. Question and answers. Okay, so what I want to do in every class is to take out some time that would normally be called office hours. So, by the way, if anybody needs to talk to me, just email me, and I'll set up a time to talk to you. But less formal discussion, or like a recitation, or whatever you want to call it. If there's any discussion you want, this is the moment. So anything we've talked about so far this semester, it's horribly warm in this room, isn't it? Should we move to 223? I mean, not today, but permanently. Okay, let's move to 2. Fine. The classroom on the second floor. From day one, I've been very unhappy with this room. I was involved in the planning of this building, so I knew the architect, and I said, hey, what went wrong? He said, what do you mean what went wrong? Nothing went wrong. Wait, those are darker, aren't they? They're obviously darker. So all they have to do is put dark drapes here as well.
It's just the fact that there's no sun.
There's what?
Because the shadow up there is the same color as this.
Oh.
I think they're the same color.
You think it's the same?
Yeah.
And it's just that we can do an experiment. So when I turn it this way, gee, you're right. Professors hate it when they're wrong, right? This is there's something wrong with the natural order when this happens. What I said to him is that it's so bright in here that at times you can't see the things on the projection screen. And he said, that's because the university put in a weak projector. He said, I am an architect. I plan these things. You don't believe it.
Oh, yeah. It's 5,600.
Yeah. Well, the architect's claim is that it's our fault, not his fault, that this projector is not bright. It's not that the room is too bright. It's that the projector is too dim. That's it? Okay. But, of course, he has to say that, even though we don't believe him. Okay, so we're going to move. So starting next week, we'll move to the other classroom. I think that means changing the class time 2:30 to 5:30 instead of 2 to 5. I don't want to work till 5:30. Sometimes you got to do what you got to do. So we changed class time. Is that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe you should
write
an email.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's something happening
in that room?
Yeah.
Supposedly.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's why
October 24th was already in that room.
That's right. One of the there was this room was taken for one day. It's a terror. This is not a good room. Okay, so maybe that was the most important topic of discussion, but we could talk about physics now. So are there any? Yes.
What about the lab?
About?
The lab. What the
lab? Oh, we don't know yet. That'll be like in the second half of the semester, and we're not going to overdo it. I mean. Each of you, well, it will be 2 hours, 4 hours, or 6 hours. I mean, each lab will be 2 hours, but there may be one or two or three, most likely two. So this is not going to be a huge time commitment. It's going to be fun. And we're working on it. We're talking, planning things out. I got a demo last week, in fact. Okay, other questions?
Actually, you require us to read the first chapter of the textbook, right?
Yes.
But 1.3, 1.4, they are like not covered.
Oh.
So it's pretty hard. But 1.3, 1.4, they are like formal definition of nonlinear susceptibility and also something.
We did that in class.
But 1.4 was not. I discussed with those.
Which is 1.4? I don't remember what.
So who has a test book? Can I use it?
Mm-hmm. So, wait, there, first. You're here to learn. The more you read, the more you're going to learn.
Yeah, I was just talking.
So, look, when I... things that are not treated in class, things that are not treated on homework, things that are not treated in lab, things that are not treated in my Wednesday lecture, are not going to be on the final exam. So parts of the book that are not covered in class or lecture is not part of the exam. But you're here to learn. So that, but okay. So you got it. That is the sense in which I said read chapter one. So you the parts that are most relevant you read in greater care than the other parts. But there's nothing there that is not, I hope, of some interest.
At 1.4, that I completed.
Oh, that's the homework.
Yeah.
So 1.4 is the homework assignment.
It's homework.
So I didn't do that in class because you're doing this on your own.
They're like so abstract.
Well, it's so abstract. That's why you're doing it for homework. It won't be so abstract anymore if you've done it yourself. Yeah. Oh, but the point I'm making is a more general one. In life, everything does not have to be up here. You have to know where the answer is. So, when you read a textbook, part of it is to say, hey, the world knows how to treat this topic, the world knows how to treat this topic, the world knows how to treat this topic. Now, these are the ones that we're really emphasizing in the course. I hate to emphasize final exam because that's not the issue. You're here to learn. And there are not enough hours in lecture that I can treat everything in the book. So read as much as you can. Learn as much as you can. That's why you're here, is to learn. No, that's the answer. Yeah.
It's
like a bear claw, isn't it?
Yeah. So when you do E&M originally, you assume that the response is always instantaneous. I assume...
Who does?
I mean, whenever you start E&M, you always learn that the E field, responds instantaneously everywhere. But then you add on that time delay, right?
Right.
So we haven't yet added on a time delay, I assume?
We have.
We have?
We just did.
Oh, yeah, right when we did the time delay.
So wait, let's go back. I assume it's okay to erase this? So let me emphasize. and this is back to linear response. If you want to work in the frequency domain, you can say that P of omega is equal to epsilon zero chi of omega times E of omega. And the imaginary part of chi one describes a delay between the response and the driving field. P omega and I guess I really have to write this in the time domain. So in the time domain, this can be delayed with respect to this. But in the frequency domain, that shows up as a phase shift, because that's how complex numbers work. And then in the time domain, we have that P of t is equal to, I guess probably the epsilon zero should have been here all along, integral zero to infinity d tau r1 of tau e of t minus tau. Okay, so here, right in front of you, the polarization at time t can depend on the field at an earlier time. And that means that the possibility of a time delay is explicitly brought out here. And then we showed that chi 1 is equal to the Fourier transform. Chi 1 of omega is the Fourier transform d tau of r1 of tau e to the plus I omega tau. I think. Did anybody check? We're testing my short-term memory now. It's wrong?
No.
Oh. Yeah. Okay, so you can do it in the frequency domain, you do it in the time domain. Here's how you go back and forth between the two. So, thank you. Other discussion? Yeah.
Yeah? When we look at the symmetry of chi 2,
yes.
We started, it's going to be a hard gel because it's a 3 times 3 tensor, and
yeah.
Then we have to consider all three frequencies, so times 3, and
yeah.
Then we have to know the complex, so times 2. Then we say, first, our fields are real, so we get rid of the times 2 for the complex. Yeah. Then we say, the two input fields, swap them.
Yes.
That's reduced again dimension, and then
we
got to, it has to be lossless.
Between?
Then we got to the point, it has to be, if we are in a lossless.
Yeah, material, yeah, yes.
Then
full print, yeah.
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 So that allows us that we can swap
the yes.
frequency as we want.
Yes.
So that we are left with 3 times 3 times 3. Am I wrong? Or is it already lower?
Well, that's the right thought. I'm not good at numerology. When I was writing the book, I worked these out and I gave the numbers. But, well, there's the 3 times 3 times 3 for the Cartesian coordinates. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
So keep these separate. For the moment, I mean.
If we don't assume Feynman,
yes.
Do we have to do all the Cartesian elements?
I think the answer is yes. These are different degrees of freedom. These are different degrees of freedom. The permutation symmetry tells you nothing about the tensor nature, because the tensor nature depends on the spatial symmetry of the interaction. The reason why it's confusing is that when you have Kleinman symmetry, it says that you can interchange all the tensor components. So that makes it seem as if there's something with the spatial symmetry, but there isn't really, because what Kleinman says is that it didn't depend on frequency to begin with. So just you should just forget about frequency and think about the Cartesian coordinates. And I forget if I said this in lecture. If I didn't, I will say it now. Kleinman would tell us that chi 1, 2, 3 is equal to chi 2, 3, 1, etc. But Kleinman never told us that chi 1, 1, 1 is equal to chi 2, 2, 2. It says you can permute the ones. Any index that's here, you can write in any order. But you can't replace it by one that isn't there. I think that might help to address, if I understand what you're getting at, it's a confusion because Kleinman seems to imply something it doesn't. So, thank you. Yeah. More discussion. This is more fun than teaching. If you start asking questions, if you stop asking questions, I have to go back to lecturing. You don't want that any more than I do. Okay, so let's start chapter 2. And chapter 2 is about Maxwell's equations. Now, in some ways, this is quite remarkable that we are well into a course in optics, and we haven't talked about propagation, have not talked about Maxwell's equations or anything. So probably we're not going to get real, real far today because I don't want this to be overwhelming. But let's just derive the wave equation. But it's just a little bit different in nonlinear optics. No, it's not different. But there are attributes, there are approximations that people often make that are no longer valid in nonlinear optics. So we have to be a little bit more cautious than usual in deriving the wave equation. So we will start off. Let me just write down the Maxwell equations. So there are the divergence equations. So del dot D is equal to rho. Del dot B is equal to 0. Maybe worth emphasizing, these are what people call the macroscopic Maxwell equations as opposed to the microscopic. So microscopic here you have an atom. The nucleus is positively charged, the electron is negatively charged. Obviously there's a huge E field right next to the nucleus. So, I mean, do you want to go through life treating an electric field that varies spatially on a distance of 10 to the minus 10 meters? I don't think so. So what people do is you define E. This is now the macroscopic E, as some volume average over little e, which is the microscopic, and we average over a distance that is much greater than, say, a Bohr radius, but is much less than the wavelength of the light that you want to use. So that is why rho is the free charge density. We don't include here the protons that make up the nucleus of every atom in our sample. So it is so common for people to forget to call this the free charge density, but that's a crucial distinction. In words, whose law is this? Gauss's law, yeah. And I guess this one doesn't have a name, right? It's the no magnetic monopoles. And then we can get to curl E equals minus partial V with respect to T. So changing magnetic field creates an electric field. So whose law is that?
Faraday.
Faraday? You said Faraday. What did you say?
I said Faraday.
You said Faraday. Ah, Now you weren't disagreeing with that was right, you were disagreeing with who said it. Okay, so this is the Faraday law. And then finally we have that curl H equals partial D with respect to T plus J. And again, this is the free current density. So this says that a changing electric field creates a magnetic field. So whose law is this?
Ampere.
Comme ça? Who's French? Ampere? Okay, so, yeah, that's right. This is Ampere's law, and this is Maxwell's correction, the displacement current correction. Yeah, question?
I have a question about this average. What
yes.
happens if we can find such a distance that's much larger than the atomic distance because the wavelength is too small?
I guess we use this one.
Okay, so we can use.
Yeah, I guess you're stuck and you have to do it. And in metamaterials, there's an intermediate scale we call the mesoscopic scale. Metamaterials, how many metamaterial people here are there? Metamaterials? Yeah. I never met a material I didn't like. Okay. So metamaterials are artificial materials. So you build your building blocks. You work on this. So in a metamaterial, you're working at still a different distance scale because you take atoms and you build artificial atoms out of the little atoms. So then you have to have three distance scales that you keep in mind all the time. And it can drive you crazy, at least at a semantic level. And actually at a real level as well, making sure you don't confuse yourself along the way. Okay, so ampere. Okay, and now how are these fields related? Well, of course, D is epsilon E plus P. this is the P we've been talking about all semester. So when we talk about the nonlinear polarization, we talk about something that fits in right there. So that is the relevance of the first two lectures to Maxwell's equations. And then, someone help me out. Is there a minus sign here? In optics, we almost never, this is almost never an issue. It is almost never an issue. So in most optics books, you just see this. But there's an additional term that maybe needs to be included when you talk about metamaterials. And I really don't know the answer. But traditionally in optics, we just set this equal to here. This is a statement that there is no magnetic response in optics. For the most part, it's the electric field that interacts with the atoms, not the magnetic field. And even to the extent that the magnetic field does, it does not usually lead to a distinction between B and H. We'll make a physical assumption that rho is equal to zero and that J is equal to zero. So there are no free charges and there are no free currents. So that's just something we will assume. Well, then how do you get radiation? It's this term here. So it's the an oscillating dipole moment shows up here. And it's been emphasized by a number of authors that you don't need both. It's like wearing a belt and suspenders. You can throw away J and put all of the currents into D, or you can throw away this and put all your currents into J. You just have to make sure that you account for everything once and not zero times and not twice. But you can put your oscillating charges in either of these two terms. And the same for rho. You can put the rho here, or you can take it to the other side of the equation and put it in the P. So we will set these equal to zero, but in a certain sense, this is not a restrictive assumption, because anything that you could put there, you can incorporate into the rest of the equations. Okay, so now let's proceed to derive the wave equation. And what we do is we take the curl of the curl, well, you can do it either way. We will take the curl of this equation and then on the right-hand side introduce this equation with a mu zero. So what you find that way is that the curl of E is equal to mu zero partial squared D with respect to T squared, I'm sorry, plus. That was it. Equal to zero. And now let's explicitly take D and set it equal to epsilon zero E plus P. Let me just, when I say P, I mean the sum of the linear and the nonlinear contributions at this point here. So we it's convenient now to put the P on the right-hand side of the equation, and we get curl E plus 1 over C squared partial squared E with respect to T squared is equal to mu 0 partial squared P with respect to T squared. Now, you know the next step, except it's much more subtle in nonlinear optics. Minus sign. Now, recall that there is a vector identity that says that the curl of the curl of any vector function is equal to the gradient of the divergence of that function minus the Laplacian of that function. And now this term here. We know that del dot D is equal to 0. I'll give you the fraudulent argument. And we know that D is epsilon E, and therefore del dot E is equal to 0. But this is wrong. Now, of course, in linear optics, you just set this equal to 0 and you move on. But in nonlinear optics, when D is epsilon 0 E plus P, del dot D vanishes, but there's no guarantee that del dot P vanishes. In fact, in general, del dot P does not vanish. Well, maybe for an infinite plane wave it vanishes, but there's no reason why the divergence of the polarization should vanish. So you have this awkward correction term that haunts you through your life, that in nonlinear optics, this is usually small, but it's very difficult to prove that it's negligible. Or it's very difficult to prove in general that it is negligible. So we really, in principle, every new problem that you take up, you should examine this point. But I'm a practical person as well, so I will set this equal to 0 for convenience. So we get rid of this, and then the wave equation becomes Laplacian of E minus 1 over C squared partial squared E with respect to T squared. And I have this personal dislike for mu naught. So I will always write it as 1 over epsilon 0 C squared. I will put this on authority. This is how Feynman always wrote it. The honest truth is that if you're brought up in CGS units or Gaussian units, this is what you get. So if you just put the epsilon zero there, you get the result that that makes sense. But look, there's a C squared in this term, so by putting the C squared here, I think it displays the underlying physics better to write it this way instead of the mu zero. But this is just a personal thing. I'm not willing to tell you that it is not true that epsilon zero mu zero is equal to 1/c². So there's nothing wrong with writing it the other way. It just it's my sense of aesthetics that makes me write it in this manner. And now, finally, let's set P equal to P linear plus P nonlinear. Let's take the linear part and move it to the left-hand side of the equation. Well, in fact, let's take P linear to be chi 1 times n. This is really a tensor, but just to make it less messy, let's write this as a scalar quantity chi. And then let's remember that n squared is equal to epsilon equals 1 plus chi 1. So that means that this expression for P linear can be written in terms of the refractive index. And now we put that all together, and we find that the Laplacian of E minus n squared over c squared partial squared E with respect to t squared is 1 over epsilon 0 c squared partial squared p with respect to t squared. And this will be our usual starting equation. For most of the problems we need to do in nonlinear optics, we've made one assumption, which we really think is valid, but as a formality, we should occasionally check and make sure that this is correct. Well, P nonlinear. It's a crucial omission. We broke the P into the linear part and the nonlinear part. We moved the linear part, and we discover that the linear part is describable by the refractive index. That's why people invented the refractive index, or one of the reasons why people invented the refractive index. What's left over on the right-hand side is the nonlinear response. I've said this last week, but let me say it again. An oscillating polarization acts as a source term that radiates new components of the electromagnetic field. And for free charges, you have Larmor's theorem that says that an accelerating charge radiates. Okay, so P, second time derivative of P, is a measure of the acceleration of the charges that constitute the dipole moments of the material. Okay, so I think this is a perfect stopping point. You see, next class will be fun, right? If you're following the logic here, right? I mean, here we are. We're in a photonics university. We finally got to the wave equation. So now we can start playing with the wave equation, seeing what its implications are for nonlinear interaction, coupling between various electromagnetic waves. Now, are there any? Is there any more discussion? We do it right now. Yes.
In the last class, there are terms in the nonlinear susceptibility that were not time dependent. I think we call that optical.
Oh yeah.
So those don't change the field inside the.
Well, they can. They don't radiate.
Yeah.
But they're there, so they're measurable.
Right.
But they don't radiate.
Right.
I think that's a good way to leave that thought. Yes?
What do you mean by you add the tilt on the row and the
D? What do I mean? All I mean is that these are time domain. I mean, everything here is in the time domain. So I guess if D is in the time domain, then this has to, I mean, you can't have the time domain on one side and the frequency domain on the other. So that's all I meant, is that if the charge was time varying, it would show up here. And if the current were time varying, it would show up here. Yeah. So that's what the notation meant.
Frequency-dependent free charge temperatures?
Sure. You take the Fourier transform of it, and you say, oh, yeah, the, which one?
Charge density.
It's weird, almost perverse, right? But I guess anything, you're allowed to take the Fourier transform of anything. So if you have, let's think this one through, plasma oscillations. So in plasma oscillations, well, we call them plasmons, but that's in the quantum regime. So if you have a plasma oscillating at the plasma frequency, you say, oh yeah, the density is moving up and down. So the at any given point, the charge density is time dependent, and then it's legitimate to ask. What frequency components are present in this oscillating charge density? So the answer is yes. Now, I have another idea. Why don't I say that class is over? You see, as soon as class is over, then everybody has questions for me. Okay, class is over. You can turn off the machine. And now everybody will want to talk to me.